broadcasting live from global headquarters and RP Enterprises in Greenwood, Missouri.
Stand by on this frequency.
After 22 years of entertaining FM radio listeners across the U.S., this man is the owner and executive producer of the award-winning Heartland Waterfowl on Sportsman's Channel, CEO and founder of Dumar Chemical Solutions, and the man behind the mic of Papa Ron Radio Voiceovers and Production. He's the man, the myth, the legend, a global icon, future Nobel Prize winner, and of course he paid me to say all this.
Really?
Literally. Welcome to the Papa Ron Podcast. Here's your host, Ronnie Phillips.
Jillian, I'm excited to see that you're still alive. You're healthy and well.
Yes.
You look really good. You're glowing. I know it's the holiday season, and that's usually something that works for you, right? You glow more in December than you do any other time of the year.
I do love the holidays. It kind of killed me not to wear a Christmas shirt today because pretty much November through December, I'm going to wear Christmas all the time.
Right.
Today, I made an exception.
You're a walking Christmas tree.
I know.
Yeah. But you missed the last podcast because you were under the weather and the family was under the weather.
Yep.
And it just happened to be, to date now, the second most listened to podcast on the Papa Ron Podcast.
Oh my gosh.
With Stephen McBee. So
maybe I should leave.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know. But I'm just saying, you contributed nothing to that success.
Okay.
I digress. I'm glad that you're here. And I'm also to have this week's guest in studio here at the global headquarters of RP Enterprises. Welcome from the Kansas City Royals, Ryan Lefebvre. Woo!
Wait, shouldn't the clap be more like?
Oh, let's go Royals.
Yeah. Like that. Yeah.
Thank you for being here, buddy. This is really, really cool. I appreciate you taking time out of your schedule, which I know was a little bit of a chore because you are a dad and your kids are in a lot of activities. In fact, when we spoke for the first time on the phone, you were on your way to Omaha for a hockey tournament.
It was.
So it means a lot. And obviously we want to get into what's going on with the Royals. There's been a lot of things happen in the offseason. Mm-hmm. But also I want the real purpose for having you here was because you and I have something in common, and having suffered from depression and anxiety, and you've got a wonderful message and a mutual friend who you go to church with, mm-hmm. who is what really kind of brought us together to have you here today and to discuss that. So we'll get into that later, but let's dive into this. So you've been with the Royals for how long now?
This will be my 25th year.
Man.
Which is crazy because I'm only 28 years old, so the math doesn't add up.
To have that success at three is incredible.
Are you serious?
25 years.
25 years.
Let me ask this. Did you, I'm 47, grew up watching George Brett, Frank White, all the guys. I'm from Marysville, Kansas, so I don't know if you guys go do your, what do they call that when you go on those?
The winter caravans.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so those would occasionally come through our little hometown.
Is that up by Conception Abbey?
No.
Okay.
Marysville would be about 45 miles north of Manhattan, Kansas.
Okay, I'm thinking of Maryville.
Maryville, Missouri.
Missouri.
Which would have been that's northwest Missouri.
Yes,
right?
Okay. That's Missouri. Okay. I'm from Kansas. Anyway. Okay.
That wasn't a very good start to the interview.
Well, you know what? Maybe we can find a graphic of a map and we can add that to the podcast.
Yeah.
And
I'll pull it up here.
Have a lesson.
And you can see from how far apart they are.
That anyway. S. I mean, it's just that S threw me off.
And I mean, I know homeschooling doesn't have to like factor into podcasting.
And the S is one of the most popular letters ever used on Wheel of Fortune, Ryan. Right. Come on. Jeez almighty. Anyway, so my point to this is I grew up listening to the Royals and Denny Matthews, Fred White, mm-hmm. K-State guy. So Fred White was a K-State guy. Rest in peace, Fred. Anyway, so I guess my question was having those guys in the longevity of these broadcasters for as long as they were, and then you come into the mix, was that intimidating?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And I think I knew what I was getting into because when I got my first job with the Minnesota Twins in 1995, I was 24 years old. And I grew up in Los Angeles, but I, of all things, I went to the University of Minnesota to play baseball. So this hasn't been confirmed, but I have to be the only person in United States history to leave Southern California to go play baseball in Minnesota. But I loved it. I love the Midwest. I have Midwest roots. My mom is from Wisconsin. My father, born and raised in Los Angeles. But it just, every baseball opportunity that I had in college was on the West Coast somewhere. And then there was Minnesota. Mm. So I won't tell you the long version of the story, but I went there basically as a favor to my father. He knew the coach, and my dad was a major league manager, and I think the coach invited me as a favor to my father. So we weren't really serious about each other, but it worked out, and I went, had a great career, got into broadcasting, and so here I am at 24 broadcasting Major League Baseball for the Twins, and I went to the University of Minnesota. I played baseball. My father was in Major League Baseball.
Yeah.
But they had an announcer named Herb Carneal, who's the Denny Matthews, since passed now, but he was the Denny Matthews of the Twins, and I would fill in for him. Mm-hmm. And the fans loved me on television for home games. They hated me on the radio because they wanted to hear Herb Carneal. They grew up with Herb Carneal.
Sure. Right.
So fast forward 4 years, and I had an agent at the time, and Fred White had been fired. So he didn't retire. He got fired.
So I'd like to, I want you to finish your story, yeah, but I want to touch on that in a second and get more clarity on that.
So Fred and Denny had been together for 25 years, the glory years of the Royals in the 70s and the 80s. And I knew both of them because the Twins played the Royals, and I got to know both of them, and they were wonderful to me. So my agent calls and says, Fred White has been fired in Kansas City. Would you be interested in that job? And
wow.
I said, no way. Are you kidding me? I'm not going to be the fool that goes to Kansas City after Fred White. I'm struggling enough to gain my footing here.
Mm-hmm. Not to mention the Royals were not doing very well.
They were not. They were not. So that was the end of that. So I go in, I'm getting ready for my fifth year with the Twins, and I'm going to go in and ask for a big raise, big raise. Now, I thought I was the richest guy in the world at that point. I mean, I'm in my 20s getting paid to do Major League Baseball, but I was like, okay, I've been doing this for 4 years. It's time for a big raise.
Yeah.
And of course, the executives in radio were much more seasoned in negotiating than I was. I went in there and laid my case out, and they just shot me down. And I went home, and I was just depressed because I didn't feel like I was asking for a lot, but they looked at me like I was a fool for what I was asking for. I look back on it now and I laugh, but then I just thought, I can't believe this. I go home and my answering machine, that this dates the story,
right, exactly,
my answering machine is blinking. Yeah. And I get a call from someone with the Royals asking me if I would be interested in the job.
Sure.
Now, they had no idea that I had told my agent 2 months ago that I wasn't interested.
Right.
So just for the sake of leverage and stirring the pot, yeah, I called him back and I said, absolutely, I'd be interested in your job.
Right.
So they fly me to Kansas City, first class on Northwest Airlines, which again dates the story.
Yep.
And first class isn't, you can't really appreciate first class on a 55-minute flight, but right, they sent me first class. I sit in first class. I open up the Minneapolis Star Tribune newspaper, and I had told a couple of people that I was going to be doing this.
No.
I open up the newspaper, and it says, Lefebvre to interview with Royals today. And I'm like, yes, I'll just go to Kansas City, have a little barbecue, go through the motions with the interview,
yeah,
go home, and they're just going to be waiting for me at the airport and begging me not to leave. Well, very, very similar to my trip to the University of Minnesota. I had the same feeling when I came here. I kind of thought to myself, you know, they treated me wonderful, by the way. And I thought, first of all, I get off the plane and I meet Bill White, was the program director at KMBZ.
Okay.
And Bill White and I found each other in the front of KCI, and I get in his car. And before we got off the grounds of the airport, he said, well, we really hope that today goes well because you're our number one candidate. Well, that kind of sat up in my chair and thought, wow, that's okay. Mm. So I started to see it through different lens. And I remember flying back to Minneapolis and thinking, you know what? I got out of my comfort zone when I left California to go to the University of Minnesota. Maybe I need to get out of my comfort zone and go somewhere else. I was coming up on 1 year sober. So it was probably time for a change and see if I could stand on my own two feet again.
And this is before this was a wife and kids and all of that. And we're going to get into your faith a little bit, but had you
shallow faith at that time, faith, but not, you know, I mean, about 20, I was probably about 25% in obeyance of my faith at that point.
Gotcha. So you were not really acknowledging those little feelings you were having. You weren't like, oh, maybe God's working all this together. You weren't really thinking that so much.
They were feelings, but I didn't connect them to, you know, that this was God's way of saying, I have something else for you.
Sure.
So I get back and I take the job, and the twins called me and said, what is there anything we can do to get you to stay? And I was like, you know what? You gave me this great opportunity when I was 24 years old. I am not going to put you and the Royals in some sort of a bidding war. If I'm going to take this job, I'm going to take this job. And so 2 days before Christmas in 1998, I left the Twins and went to the Royals, and immediately thought, what in the world have I just done? Mm-hmm. And so anyway, I was visiting my grandparents at the time in Wisconsin. And sorry, this story is becoming like War and Peace here, but
it's okay. It's okay.
I told my grandparents, okay, I don't know if I've done the right thing or not, but I'm going to Kansas City and I'll take you out to dinner. Small town outside of Milwaukee, Wisconsin. There's a restaurant called the Coral Reef on the Blue Fox River in Rochester, Wisconsin. And the special that night, soon as we walked in the door, and you know those, like the mirror with the fluorescent marker on there that tells you the special, the Kansas City Strip, which that was God's way of saying, I got you. Yep. But I knew what I was getting myself into.
You've ordered the special, right?
I don't remember if I did or not.
It says Kansas City Strip.
That's
great,
but I'll have.
Can I have the salmon?
Yeah. Can I have the chicken fingers with mac and cheese?
Right.
So, I knew what I was getting myself into and it was tough the first 2 years, but thankfully there was no social media. So there were fewer ways for people to tell me they hated me back then. It was letters to the editor and people calling into the talk shows. But, the first few years were tough until Denny Matthews decided in his third year that he wanted to remove a couple of road games and Fred White filled in. So all the people that hated me and missed Fred, even though Fred was going around town telling people to give me a chance, now all of a sudden Fred and I are on the air together getting along and laughing and talking baseball. And that was a turning point for me in Kansas City. I think fans thought, well, Fred can tolerate this clown. You know, maybe we can too.
Why was he fired?
So, back filling in.
Well, I think they felt that the broadcast had become stale and Denny and Fred had been together for so long that they just needed a young voice.
Okay.
And, you know, Fred was the change because Denny had been here since year one in 1969. The Royals then hired Fred shortly after that. And then they thought, you know, fans still miss Fred. We're talking about 20 games a year. Why don't we just put Fred back on the air with Ryan? And I don't know if they realized what they were doing, but it was a tremendous blessing for me. I mean, I think fans started to listen to me differently when they heard Fred doing games with me and talking to me like a broadcast colleague and a friend.
Yeah. Being the veteran broadcaster, and as mature as he was, it sounded like he handled it very, very well and had no animosity, obviously, with the organization. Or maybe did he? I don't know. I'm just saying, if he was to then be invited to come back and fill in and he's walking around town telling people to give you a chance, he must have handled it with high character.
He did. He did. And I know we'll get into this later, but I mean, he was a close confidant when I was going through my depression in 2005. I mean, he was one of the few people that saw something different in me and forced me to talk about it with him and would not accept the, how are you doing? And I would say, fine, like every guy does. I mean, well, no, really, how are you doing? And I mean, he really helped break down some walls, in 2005 when I was rock bottom.
Okay. Fascinating. What's the deal with Denny now?
Well, Denny turned 80 this year.
Right.
And so this will be his 55th year.
So broadcasting.
He keeps doing less and less games, yeah, though, yeah, every year. How many games is he slated to do this year?
Down to home games now. Just and, you know, he whittled it down to Chicago and St. Louis. He loves Chicago. He loves St. Louis. You know, he grew up a Cardinal fan. And I think there's a part of him, as long as he's been with the Royals, that he still is a Cardinal fan. I mean, you know, that's hard to believe.
You heard it here first on the Papa Ron podcast, folks.
Not more than the Royals, but I think he just, there's still a...
He's got a sweet spot for
a kid in him as a baseball fan that you know, that doesn't just go away. So he went to St. Louis this year. That was his only trip. Funny story about that, too, is Denny and I for years now, and he's been... Denny's been wonderful to me. I mean, I'm so grateful for Denny Matthews. And I only do about 30 radio games a year now. Most of my games are on television, but I do all home games on radio because I want to work with Denny.
That's the reason why.
Yeah, that's why I do all home games on radio. So we've had this ritual for years. We fly in and out of the downtown airport when the Royals go in and out of town. And so Denny will leave his car at the stadium, and he and I for years will just drive from Kauffman Stadium to downtown, and we sit and we talk. I mean, it's my favorite 15 minutes of the week when just being in the car with Denny. And so last year his only trip was to St. Louis. And so we get in the truck, in my truck, and he sits down and shotgun, and I say, "Well, here you go. Your first trip of the year." And he goes, "And my last trip of the year too." So that was it. One trip to St. Louis and that was his, that's the extent of his traveling now.
How many years has he been on the air with the Royals?
This will be number 55.
Unbelievable.
He's the longest current tenured broadcaster in the major league. It's not even close. No one's even close to 55 years, but Vin Scully went 67 years. And then Jaime Harin, who was coincidentally the Dodgers' Spanish-speaking broadcaster, he retired last year, and he had gone more than 60 years with the Dodgers. And now, at the very top of the mountain, is Denny Matthews with 54 going on 55 years with the Royals.
And so you're how long? 25?
It'll be 25.
But total 30?
29. Four with the Twins, yeah.
Right. So do you think you'll hit 50? Like if you today you had to say, "I'm going to mark this, I'm going to put it in a time capsule that I'm going to make it to broadcast year 55.
Well, I'm going to steal a line from Joe Buck, you know, whose father, Jack, was a, and is an institution, even though he's passed in St. Louis. And Joe said years and years ago, when his dad was still doing games with Parkinson's and was just hanging in there, Joe said, "Nobody ever does fewer years than they say they're going to, or the years they say they're going to." Everybody goes longer than they say they're going to do it. So for me to say, there's no way I'm going to make it to 55 years, you know, it's a great job. You know, I have four young children at home right now, so it's not great for our family during the baseball season. But, you know, when the kids are out of the house and my wife can travel with me and, you know, I think when broadcasters get into 60s and 70s, and the kids are all out of the house, the job changes quite a bit. It's not as much of a burden on the family.
And it's hard to know what technology is going to be like in that time. You know, like it's just, you think about the evolution of where radio was 25 years ago and where it is today and all the different social media and digital distribution outlets. I mean, it's just hard to really project where you're going to be. They might have robots broadcasting games for us. You know what I mean? I'm not really, but you know, it's...
Well, for the 2 years of COVID, we did the games, the road games from Kauffman Stadium off the television monitors. So, I mean, we proved it's easier to do on television than it is on radio, doing the games remotely, because, you know, on TV, if I get locked up and I'm not sure what's happening, you can still see what's going on the screen. It's much harder on radio, because if you're locked up and you don't know what to say on radio and people are in their car and you stop talking, nobody knows what's going on. But I think we proved in those 2 years that at least television can be done remotely.
That's fascinating.
That is fascinating.
Do you think, how long do you think Denny's going to keep going?
Well, my line has always been, this puts things into perspective. Denny started broadcasting Royals games 2 years before I was born. So I always say he's going to broadcast games 2 years until after I'm dead. And I'm 51 now. So, but here, I tell you what, here's life full circle. Okay. So Steve Physioc retired after this year.
And we hired
Jake Eisenberg, who's our broadcaster at Triple A Oman. He was a fill-in for the New York Mets.
Yeah.
He's going to be 28 years old on opening day this year.
I heard him on with Stephen St. John a couple mornings ago, and he sounds like he's a sharp guy.
He's really good, really good, and a great, great young man. But he'll be 21 when the season starts this year. I was 28 when I came to the Royals. And Denny is the same age as my father. My father is 80. Denny's 80. Mm. And I'm about the same age as Jake's dad is. So you talk about life going full circle. I mean, it's kind of like you realize, like, I'm in this different life category now. Yeah. You know?
Wow.
So he knows to call me sir all year, you know, being a young man on the job here. So.
You laid that foundation.
That's right
away.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Or maybe his dad raised him that way and just said, no, you get in there. You refer to him as Mr. Lefebvre.
That's right. That's
Speaking of your dad, since he was in baseball, did he expect you to play baseball? Like, was that like, did he expect you to go from college to the major leagues, or was the broadcast thing like, was that what you wanted to do, or did you want to play baseball past college? Or?
You know, it's a really interesting story, Jillian. I mean, my parents divorced when I was four. They were separated when I was 18 months old. So I'd never had dad home. Mm-hmm. And the reality of it was, I mean, baseball was his number one priority. And so when my parents divorced, he was free to pursue whatever he wanted to do in baseball. He was rookie of the year in 1965 with the hometown team, the Dodgers. He went mm-hmm. to two World Series. I mean, he played with Sandy Koufax and Don Drysdale, and he played against Willie Mays and Hank Aaron and Stan Musial. I mean, in the golden age of baseball. Then he got into coaching, and then he was a manager and so on and so forth. Our only connection was sports mm-hmm. and baseball. I mean, we didn't really have a father-son relationship with, you know, talking about girls and mm-hmm. the future and alcohol and things to look out for as you're getting older and stuff like that. I mean, he was more of an uncle than a father.
Gotcha.
But I would spend summers with him, and I got to hang around the ballpark, and which was a great introduction to just major league protocol. How do you behave at the ballpark and who's who? And so after I was done playing in college, I was drafted by the Cleveland Indians, and I played in the minor leagues for 2 weeks, and I quit. I was just done. I was time to do something other than do what every Lefebvre boy is supposed to do and play baseball.
Did you know that going into I'm assuming when you say you quit after 2 weeks, was that into spring training or what
after the college season? Drafted in June, and then it must have been, you know, you're July going or August.
Diving right. That's right. Obviously, you're right into the season, and you lasted 2 weeks. Did you feel that possibility of removing yourself from the game before you were drafted? And then maybe you just felt like, well, I have to kind of see this through. I've been drafted. I need to go check it out. Or did you have reservations about being done with it before then?
I mean, I was a good player. I was always one of the better players on my team. So I liked that. And I was an only child until I was 13 years old, and then I started having half siblings. Mm-hmm. And I always wanted to have siblings, and I was an only child in a very big extended family. I had cousins all over the place, and they had two or three, four siblings, and I was very envious of that. So I think sports, that was my family. And so hanging out with the guys and being a good player. But I remember after my sophomore year in college, I was invited to play in the Cape Cod League, which is a very exclusive college summer league. They use wooden bats. And I mean, if you play well in the Cape Cod League, I mean, all the major league scouts are watching you. And so to be invited back then, I mean, if you were invited, you had no choice. You just had to go to the Cape Cod League. And I remember that was the first time where I was with a bunch of guys that I didn't really know. And I remember thinking, these guys are into this way more than I'm into it. And I started to realize, you know, how much do I care about it this much? I miss my buddies back in Minnesota who were playing in a, you know, like a beer league, summer league, just to keep their skills up.
Right.
And then I went back my junior year, and I was invited to go back to Cape Cod again. So I went back a second summer, and I had my first internship at a radio station in Falmouth, Massachusetts, WCIB Radio, which is now an automated affiliate. They no longer have an office with a program director and announcers anymore. And I loved it. And I went back and I started doing a lot of work on the campus station at the University of Minnesota. So I think that's when the fork in the road began. Gotcha. So I finished my senior year, I get drafted. And after 2 weeks, I'm just like, I'm done. I just want to go do something else. My dad handled it great, believe it or not. I think my dad understood. He never really pushed baseball on me. He told me years later, he said, I decided that I would throw batting practice and I would play catch with you, but I wasn't going to coach you until you asked me to coach you. So he really didn't coach me until end of high school and into college. But when I quit, I mean, he handled it. I don't know how he felt about it, but he handled it great. My mom, on the other hand, thought I was making a huge mistake and I'd regret this. And but thankfully, my broadcasting career took off shortly after that.
That is true. I mean, to be at the level of where you were at 24 years is, that doesn't happen to every Tom, Dick, and Harry who gets into radio. That's were very, very blessed. Do you ever, did you, being as young as you were and trying to kind of navigate your way through the broadcasting infancy stages of your broadcasting career, ever look back and go, gosh, dang, maybe I did make a mistake. Maybe I should have stuck it out.
I wondered sometimes because, you know, being 24 years old in the major leagues, I mean, for 10 years, I was broadcasting guys that I played against in high school and in college in the Cape Cod League. I mean, guys that I thought at times I was better than,
I bet.
And these guys are in the major leagues now, you know? And, but I don't think so. I mean, for whatever reason, early in my broadcasting career, day games with a big crowd, there were times where I thought, man, I wish I was down there. This would be fun. But by and large, I was able to go back to my measuring stick and say, okay, let's remember everything that goes into it. And did I want to spend all those years in the minor leagues, not knowing if I was going to make it or not? So I was able to reel myself back in. But yeah, there were moments where I thought, you know, would I, you know, how would I have done if I had, if I had hung in there? But I loved broadcasting so much that that just kind of overshadowed any possible regret I may have had.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you say 3:30 or 3? What?
3:30.
Okay. Yeah. So got about 45 minutes. I got a lot to get to. All right. So one of this, I did this with, I think we did this with Louis Aguiar when we had on, we would mention a name of a person that maybe played with or who's been a part of the association. And then you give us like a quick one or two word response to your,
what your first initial comes to mind or what you overall think of them or whatever.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, let's start with the master, right? He's the biggest name in Royals program, George Brett.
Great storyteller. That's the first thing that comes to mind. I mean, George Brett is the rare person where I've heard him tell the same story 10 times and it's entertaining all 10 times. There's a little tweak every time. I mean, it's, there's some guys who tell a story a second or third time and you just want to drive forks into your eyes because you're like, oh,
I know guys like that.
Uncle with this story, you know, George is the opposite. I mean, he is, he's gone from being a Hall of Fame baseball player to just a Hall of Fame baseball ambassador.
Right.
I love that.
Okay. Frank White.
Friend, when I came to the Royals and talked about what the adjustment was like, he was on the coaching staff and a legend, his number was retired and a statue and all that stuff.
And then eventually was on the TV broadcast.
He was great to me as a coach. And then when Paul Splittorff got sick and they just, Frank was doing some pregame and postgame with Joel Goldberg just to kind of learn broadcasting. Then all of a sudden he's doing the games very early in the season in 2009. And he said to me one time, and he was true to his word. He used to say, out there, and he's pointing from the booth to the field, out there, I'm that guy. And he's pointing to his retired number. He goes, but up here, I'm a rookie. And he was incredibly humble. I mean, he really wanted to learn. He was nervous before every game because he just, he wanted to do a good job. And he would say something every game. I mean, because Paul Splittorff used to tell me the basics of the game have not changed from the very beginning, but the way that we describe them over time changes based on the culture.
Yeah.
So you might describe the mechanics of a swing differently in 1970 as you do 2022, but you're talking about the same thing,
same motion.
So I've heard a lot of the same things over and over again, but Frank would say something every game where we would just be like, I've never heard that before. That's fascinating. He could see the game differently. And from the beginning, I didn't grow up in Kansas City. I knew who Frank was as a baseball fan, but he always just treated me as a friend.
Well, I'm going to detour here for a little bit because the word on the street was that there, you know, we talked about Fred White and his mm-hmm. character and how he handled that being fired from the team in that broadcast. Same thing happened to Frank White. Is mm-hmm. that correct?
Yeah.
And he, rumor on the street, is did not handle it as well and maybe did have some hard feelings about that. What can you speak to about that?
Well, I think first and foremost, Frank wanted to manage. And so he had been a major league coach. Mm-hmm. And I don't think in the end he felt like, you know, the Royals weren't going to see him as a future manager. So he went into the front office. He eventually did some community relations, which he's great in public. Mm-hmm. I mean, the fans love him and he's top notch at making a fan feel like they're important. It's just not a fan going through the assembly line and nice to meet you. And then the next one, I mean, he really would make eye contact and was just great with the fans.
Right.
But he wanted to manage and he wouldn't let go of it. So instead of just rolling his 8 gold gloves and his retired number out there and saying, I should manage, he went to the minor leagues and managed at AA to just prove that he could be a manager. He went to Wichita. Alex Gordon was there. Yeah. Billy Butler was there. Luke Hochaver was there. Guys who ended up being big names. And it just wasn't the right fit. Frank being a manager in the big leagues and the new regime, Dayton Moore coming in and wanting to do different things. I think if everybody was honest on the Royals side, a manager is hired to be fired. That's just the way it is. Mm. And I don't know how they viewed Frank's credentials as a manager, but nobody wanted to be in a position at some point to have to fire Frank White. And so I think there was just apprehension on the Royals side. And I think Dayton Moore had a vision for the type of manager that he wanted to steer this organization in the right direction. And so I think that was off the table. Mm-hmm. And so who wouldn't want Frank White to be a part of the organization? So then the broadcasting thing happened for him. Mm. But I don't know if he ever really let go of being manager. Mm. And so after the 2011 season, the change was made to take him off of the broadcast and they wanted a more colorful, energetic television analyst, you know, that which perfectly fits Rex Hudler.
Right.
But it was an ugly end to his era in the Royals organization. And I'm sad for both sides because I love them both. Yeah. I love the people who are involved on the Royals side at that point. And I love Frank. And I have tried with what little influence I have to bring the two back together. And it's, you know, since then, you know, the Glass family has moved on. Dayton Moore has moved on. And so hopefully now, you know, there's an opportunity for Frank to be reunited with the organization.
I hope so.
Yeah.
So it was regardless. He was, I mean, you talked about who wants to fire Frank White as the manager, but then he ended up getting fired anyway. And then, you know, there was the talk around the streets was that he was so, as a former player, Gold Glove winner, like very direct with his analysis of the game. Mm-hmm. It sometimes could be portrayed as negative.
Yeah.
And sometimes they did not want, and especially during a time when the team wasn't doing very well, they didn't want to be showing negativity through the broadcast during what was already felt like a negative time. And then you bring in somebody, as you said, as colorful as Rex.
Right.
And then that caused a whole nother uproar. Talk about maybe, and I want to get into a few other people associated with the association, but kind of, because I think it's important in this conversation to kind of talk about the transition through the different parts of your career. What was that like trying to reel in and navigate through a time when a lot of the community or some of the community were speaking disparagingly against Rex Hudler?
Well, I'll address the Frank thing first. So a baseball coach or a manager has to guard against getting caught up in the emotion of the moment in a game. They have to be a play ahead, an inning ahead, two innings ahead, whatever. Mm-hmm. So there's the immediate emotion when something good happens or bad happens, but they have to be thinking ahead. Okay, so that's how Frank thought. Because as a manager and a coach, that's how we thought. So, for instance, this would happen on the broadcast. Okay, we're down by two runs. Okay, in the bottom of the eighth inning, Billy Butler comes up with the bases loaded, and hits a ball to the gap, and two runs come around to score. Billy tries to stretch it into a double, and he's out at second base, okay? The crowd's roaring because Billy gets a big hit in the eighth inning, and he ties the game. And I think that's probably reflected in my voice. You know, okay, he's out, too bad, whatever, but the game's tied in the eighth inning, right? Mm-hmm. That's the broadcast and selling the team, that's what we should be talking about. Frank would be thinking about Billy should not have been trying to take second base right there. So his angle would be Billy has to know you got to hold it first. You got to let so-and-so come up, whatever. Mm-hmm. His job is not to run. His job's to hit. So I think, I don't think he meant anything in a negative context, but that's just how he, that's how a player and a coach and a manager sees the game.
Right. But so he was kind of killing the moment in a way. He was taking the like, of the moment, of the excitement, of the good part of it, and going, yeah, that's all good, but let's talk about this and what, right?
Exactly. I think from a fan and the organization's perspective was that Frank was taking the negative angle to that, where I think Frank just had the coach's mindset of, okay, that's great, but I sure wish we had another guy coming up right now, but now the inning's over because he's out at second base.
And at the time you were doing the broadcast, you didn't feel like, man, you're kind of peeing in my Cheerios here.
I did. And we talked to Frank about that, you know, and he was great. I mean, Frank would not look at me like, oh, what do you think? You know, he really understood that, okay, from a broadcast standpoint, we got to sell the two-run double and all that. So I think the organization and some fans felt like he was being negative, but I don't think he was intentionally being negative. That's just a perception. He saw the game.
That's fair.
So now Rex Hudler comes into the mix the next year. No ties, no ties to the Royals, no ties to Kansas City.
He's
But he's coming in with a guy who does have ties to Steve.
Steve Physioc, who... Mm-hmm. Born in New Jersey, but was raised in Kansas City and went to Shawnee Mission East and K-State and everything. So Hud comes in, and he's completely the opposite of Frank White. Right. He's different from anybody Kansas City's ever had in sports broadcast history, as far as I know.
Yes.
And the team is still losing 90 games in 2012, and he's telling everybody, you know, how great everything is. And he's, you know, jumping out of the booth if Billy Butler hits the two-run double to tie the game in the eighth inning. Who cares that he's thrown out at second base?
Yeah, right. Yeah.
And so, and unfortunately for him, compared to my beginning here, there was social media. Mm-hmm. And there was more ways for people to express their displeasure toward him.
That's a nice way of saying
it. Yeah, and I felt for him.
Yeah.
Because I knew... in his heart, he was doing exactly what the Royals hired him to do.
Absolutely.
He was being who he was and who he is. And it wasn't his fault that he never played for the Royals. It wasn't his fault that he came in after Frank White.
Yeah.
And so, but I related to his pain to some degree, because I remembered what it was like being an outsider and coming in after a legend. Fred White for me, Frank White for him. Very similar names. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And But he had to adjust. He wasn't in Southern California working for Disney anymore. He was in Kansas City.
Right.
Different market, different mindset. And so...
What year did they come in?
2012.
Okay, so I want to ask you then, did you have a relationship? You have a relationship with all the broadcasters, and they came from the Angels, right? Mm-hmm. So you knew of them. You had a relationship to some degree with them. Did you have a level of impatience when he came in and it was so much outside of the box of what you and all of the fellow Royals broadcasters had been doing in this little parameter here? Because I know I've heard Rex talk on 810 and other various outlets about how much credit he gives you with the patience that you've had for him and kind of guiding him along the way and some things. Did you ever have a moment where you're like, oh my God, Rooks, pump the brakes on this a little bit? You know,
sure.
I remember one time where I felt like you were going to lose your mind when Rex is talking about Salvi possibly one day wearing pinstripes like, don't do it. Don't say it. You knew exactly where he was going. So the question is that, has he ever tested your patience?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And I've tested his as well. I think the first year I felt obligated to clear the runway as much as I could for him because others had done that for me. Mm-hmm. And I felt like my job the first year was to give him as much credibility as I could and play and work around with his personality. Mm-hmm. When I started with the Twins in 95, Dick Stockton, the legendary broadcaster for CBS and Fox, was doing about 25 games a year for the Oakland A's just because he missed baseball and wanted to do some baseball. And I got to talk to him. And he told me something I'll never forget. He said, your job as a television play-by-play announcer is to make your analysts sound good. You work around him, he doesn't work around you. And I never forgot that.
Wow.
That was the red letter version of how I should handle my analyst. Mm-hmm. And so I've worked with so many different analysts. So here comes Hud, who's so different from anyone I've ever worked with. But it was, first of all, my obligation to, with whatever I could, give him credibility in Kansas City with the fans who are now used to me. Mm-hmm. And also work around him, because that's my job as a play-by-play announcer. So I think I was so focused on that the first year that there were times where I had to, I don't say I had to, like I was a professor or something like that, but there were times where he would ask for feedback and I would give him honest feedback. I probably wouldn't have said that, or I might have stopped right there and not continued. And he, very humble, modest man. Despite the flamboyance, there is a very humble person with a good heart.
Yeah, he seems to be pretty thick-skinned, and he's a sponge for, like, I want to learn, I want to grow, I want to improve.
That all the time. Yeah. So, and then I think over, and it was a big change for me too, because up to that, I worked with Denny Matthews on radio. I was the young guy on radio, and I worked with Paul Splittorff and Frank White on TV. So I was the young guy who was that would bring some humor to the broadcast, because I was working with older broadcasters. And then all of a sudden, like overnight, I became the straight man. Like, how did I become the straight man? But I had to do that to balance
to him. Let him be him.
And so I'd say I think Hud would mention this too. I mean, we had some rough years together, because there was a tug of war of, he really wanted to do the broadcast. As he would put it, he wanted to give a full HUD on the broadcast every night. And I felt like there needed to be a professional side of it. And I ended up going way farther beyond conservative on the broadcast than I ever was before, because I felt like there was this tug of war. But I think over time, we've had some really good heart-to-heart conversations over the years, where I had to give some and he had to give some, and I think we've met in the middle.
I think so too, and I think you guys do a fabulous job. Yeah. And obviously, I think that with any time you're pairing someone who's not familiar with themselves, regardless of how in tune you are with the game, there's going to be a learning curve. There's going to be a stepping stone progress to this, and so it was probably unfair. And look, this is fans or people in general, right? We're just so quick to react. We're so quick to go to social media. It wasn't fair to you guys, and in particular Rex, that he got the criticism that he did. But I personally, as a fan, have seen significant growth, and you guys are now like two peas in a pod, I think. And so kudos to you.
Thank you
for the progress that you've been in, and just to be able to have the patience with one another to work through that. I guess my next question to that was, how long do you think it took before you finally got to where you're at today? Did it take 2 years, 1 year?
No, I think it took longer than that. I mean, I think there was probably a healthy tension for several years, in a way where the tension played well on the air, like the exchange you're talking about with the pinstripe things with Salvi, or Hud thinking the moon was a planet, and those little exchanges.
Forgot
and,
about that. And we, I do remember that.
And we would have arguments on the air, and it was mostly good nature, but there was always this tension between the two of us that unfortunately grew over time. And I think probably the roughest year he and I had was in 2019. And here's what I didn't want to do to Hud ever, is I never wanted to embarrass him on the air. Now, he's very thick-skinned, and he takes it all in stride. But the feedback I was getting from the fans was, if I'd run into someone in the grocery store or in the parking lot, they'd say, I love listening to you and Hud. And my favorite part is when he says something goofy and you call him out.
Yes. Okay?
And over time, I started thinking, no one's talking about our analysis of the game.
Right.
No one's talking about what we're supposed to be doing. But that would come up like over and over again. And I was very careful to measure that, because I never wanted HUD to sound like a fool on mm-hmm. the air. Mm-hmm. So for instance, the moon being a planet thing was, I had, every time he would say something off the wall, I had to decide, like, am I going to correct him on the air? Which the two of you know, you never do that to your partner on the air. Mm-hmm. You find a way to make the correction without saying, no, Jillian, that's not what happened. You know what I mean? It's just, right. it's just, right. It's one of the first rules yeah. in broadcasting. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to correct him on the air. I don't want to belittle him on the air.
Right.
I don't want to ignore it, because then I'm guilty by association. So if he says the moon is a planet and I just don't respond to it, well, maybe people think that I think the moon is a planet. So I had to find a way to just have some fun with it.
Right.
Right. And the feedback I kept getting was how much the fans enjoyed HUD saying something goofy and me correcting him. And I didn't like that. Mm. I didn't want to be, that's all we're known for, is that. So I remember it was 18 or 19, and I just kind of decided, I said, fine, if the fans want a show
right.
greater than a play-by-play broadcaster and an analyst, then fine, I'll do that. And I took it too far.
Oh.
Took it too far, and...
I don't recall this.
Well, I mean, there wasn't a singular incident.
Okay.
But I think I went, like, okay, fine, then I'll give them that.
So you guys were, it was more like what would be like a morning show shtick. Well, you're the straight yeah. guy and he's the
we would
goofy
be,
guy and you're trying to make, like, that's emphasize
what,
him.
That's what people wanted, yeah. I guess. I didn't like it.
Right.
So when you say you took it too far, does that mean that the organization came back and they were reprimanding you, or you hurt Rex Hudler's feelings and there was some tension there? Because
so there were a few things that happened. One, I remember we were the game was over and we were on camera. And he said, he goes like, I got to tell you a quick story. And it's just, the story went on and on and on. And I said to him on the air, I'm like, I thought this was going to be the short version of the story, which everyone at home was thinking the same sure. thing. But I think there's a few things that built up. And to his credit, he came up to me before a game. There's a suite at the ballpark where I sit and I do my work before the game. And very few people know that that's where I am. It's nice and quiet. I can get mm-hmm. my work done. I can't get my work done at home with four kids. So
right.
mm-hmm. my wife and I have an agreement that if I'm home, I'm home. I'm not holed up somewhere doing my work.
Yeah.
So I go early and I do my work. And he came in one day and he told me that I had hurt his feelings in a few different things that I said on the air.
Mm.
And I acknowledge him because I thought he was right. But at the same time, I thought, you know what? The wrong thing to do here is to argue with him.
Mm-hmm.
So I just went, okay. But I was somewhat offended by it because I thought, I'm doing what you want to do. You're not doing what I want to do. I'm doing what you want to do. And I didn't handle the rest of the 19 season very well.
Mm.
And to be honest, I wasn't probably ready to do the 2020 season if we had started on time. But then COVID hits and we wonder if we're going to work at all,
right?
You know, and we end up doing 60 games. There were no fans at during the home games. And we had I think Rex is a man of faith too.
Mm-hmm.
And I think our faith played a role of, like, you know, we're lucky we get to do these 60 games. I mean, a lot of people lost money in 2020. So don't get me wrong, but the two of us, you know, we lost 100 games of income. And yeah. then it was like, you know what, we're lucky that we get to do these 60 games. We got along. We got through 2020 just fine. And then before 2021, before our first spring training game, he came out to my house. And we live on some acreage not far from here in Greenwood. And I made a big fire in the backyard. And he and I just had a heart-to-heart. And he said a bunch of things that he needed to say. I said a bunch of things that I needed to say. And we got on the same page, and we really haven't had an issue since.
Was the idea of him coming out and sitting by the fire and having a conversation, was that premeditated because you guys both felt something that you needed to get off your chest?
Yeah, and I think he would tell you that it was time for us to have a talk.
Mm.
And so a new season was coming up, a new full season was coming up. And he came out, and we were just kind of small talking, and we were getting along, and we were laughing. And I remember thinking to myself, you know what, maybe the purpose of this, my intent was, we need to get some stuff out. I need to say some things, and I need to give him the freedom to say what he needs to say and just receive it and not argue with it, but just hear his heart and where he's coming from.
Right.
But we were just kind of laughing and having a good time. And I remember thinking to myself, you know, maybe that conversation isn't tonight. Maybe tonight is just sitting around and putting some hot dogs over the fire and just chatting and having a good time. But then he actually initiated, you know, hey, you know, the last couple of years, and he just kind of spilled his guts, so I spilled my guts, and
it's just you two.
It was just the two of us out there, and it was overdue.
Hmm.
Were you nervous?
The only thing, no,
because you guys had been doing it for a while together. Yeah, and you even through the World Series.
Yeah, and I think deep down we both cared a lot for each other, but we just weren't, you know, we just weren't connecting in a way. Yeah. And all I could do was just address what I felt like I was doing wrong. And here's the reason why. And I think he understood where I was coming from, that I wasn't really dissing him in any way. And then he told me where he was coming from, which made me understand that.
Where was he coming from?
I think, you know, one of the things that used to bother him is that he would try and praise my playing career on the air. I was a college baseball player. He was a 10-year major leaguer. Mm-hmm. My father was a major league player, manager, and coach.
Right.
I knew, I mean, this is an advantage of me growing up in the major leagues. I know who I am, mm-hmm. and I know who I am not. I'm not one of them. I'm not one of the guys. A lot of guys in my business, because we fly with them and we stay in the same hotels and we socialize with them occasionally. Mm-hmm. I don't hardly at all, because I'm getting older and they're getting younger. but I think I knew my place at the beginning of my career, and I hung out with them when I was younger and they were younger. But I felt like, in a healthy way, I'm not one of them. And I think they respected the fact that I wasn't like, hey, can I hang out with you guys? You know, I give them their space. They're a player. Mm-hmm. This is about the players. Mm-hmm. It's not about me. But I think HUD wanted to talk about my playing career, which I was a college baseball player. And I played 2 weeks in the minor leagues. And I wouldn't go there because I was so afraid, because of how I was raised, that I wasn't a college football star that didn't play in the NFL. I was a college baseball player. And there's a
huge
long
difference.
Gap between college right. baseball
yeah.
and Major League Baseball. Whereas college bat, like if you're a star at KU and you never play in the NBA, you're always going to be a star at KU playing basketball.
People are still going to know your name.
If you're a star football player at Alabama and you don't make it to the NFL, you're always going to be a star. If you're a star college baseball player, that's all you are.
Hmm.
And I was always guarded that someone would be rolling their eyes because I'm talking about my college baseball career. So I had to explain to him, look, I'm not ignoring what you're saying. It's just very uncomfortable for me because it just doesn't feel right to me to talk. Well, that made sense to him. He's like, well, I was just trying to, and I was doing. So it was just good to talk about a lot of things. And, it was just two grown men who cared about each other, cared about our jobs, wanted to be true to our faith. And I'll never forget that night. I mean, our relationship has never been better beginning with that night in my backyard.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's so sweet.
That is really cool. Do you feel like it was long overdue?
Yeah. I could have initiated that conversation a lot sooner, but I was stubborn, and I was right and he was wrong. And, but it wasn't working, and I could have handled that a lot better. And I was resentful, and I really regret that year or so when we could have nipped that in the bud.
Yeah. Well, for whatever,
there were probably lots of things to blame that on too, though, because you're talking about the time frame being 2020.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, nothing was normal. So that's kind of a normal spot to just say, everything's ridiculous right now. Mm-hmm. Like nothing's like it should be. Nothing feels normal. Nothing feels right. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's just that. I don't know if you did that or not, but I mean, that was a hard time to address really anything out of the ordinary, I think.
Yeah. And if we had started on time in 2020, I don't know how 2020 would have gone, but to lose 100 games and now we're down to 60.
Yeah.
And it was like, I think we both were just grateful to be working again. Yeah. And then it was like, okay, even though we hadn't talked about it, like how bent out of shape do we want to be about this? I mean, look at what's going on in the world right now. So that set the stage for the conversation the next year.
I mean, it's easy and normal for you to feel the regret, but as people of faith, I think that we all understand that God's got a plan for everything that happens, right? And so maybe that's the way it was intended to work out, you know, probably was. I was going to say, I'm trying to be really cautious of time here. Gosh, we got 15 minutes left and so much to talk about. Oh my gosh. Okay.
I could practically walk here from my house. So we could have a part two sometime.
Yeah,
we might have to do
go.
That. Okay. But as a fan who watches the games, lots of games, aside from the first couple of years when you guys are still trying to kind of figure each other out, I did not see that. Now I would see the banter, you know, that you guys would have, for me, that was raw authenticity. That was people, two guys that are buddies that are hanging out, they're talking baseball, and they're having this little disagreement, just like no more than me and a buddy who would be at a ball game would be doing the same thing or on a golf course, right? And so I kind of connected, and I think what you found was the feedback that you were getting is that people connected because that was real. That was real conversation instead of just talking about statistics and baseball, and a lot of things that you guys talk about are so much above the pay grade as the normal fan. Mm-hmm. But that's what you are at. That's what you're trained to do. You know, that's what you were brought up to do for all those years that you've been doing broadcasting. I think there is an element of that you should, and you probably do. So I'm not trying to, talk to you like I'm a professor, but
you're a listener and you're a fan.
I am. And I'm just trying to say, man, that is something special that you guys have as a connection as broadcasters that you should not sweep under the rug.
Well, I go back to COVID again, and I think I realized, I knew, I would tell the both of you, I knew that those 3 hours every night were designed for people that had real things going on in their life, that they just wanted to sit and they just wanted to watch the game.
Right.
And I remember after the 2016 presidential election, which obviously people are still talking about today, that there were, and I don't have a Twitter account. I don't do social media, but I have a burner account where I follow five people literally, and it's all Royals related. I look at it for news, but I never tweet. Nobody knows what my handle is or whatever.
Yeah.
But I remember being really disappointed that people in our industry were straying out of their lane and suddenly they're political experts and it's just like, I know these guys. What, you're not a politician. You don't know any. Who do you think you are? Mm-hmm. I mean, and I was really turned off by that. And then I thought to myself, holy cow, do I do that on the air? I mean, obviously I don't make political statements on the air, but do I make comments that are my opinion every now and then that people are watching and saying, I don't care what you think about this or that or whatever. My job is to try and describe the game on radio and television as accurately and as honestly as I can for 3 hours so that people can enjoy the game and enjoy the players and hopefully weave in a story there that's interesting. So after the election, I thought, you know what? I want to be careful that if I have an opinion about bunting or defense or whatever, that it doesn't become about what I think, you know?
Oh, yeah.
So I want to be careful about that. So so that was the beginning of it. And then after COVID, I thought, you know, more than ever, people just want to watch the game for 3 hours. Mm-hmm. They don't want to hear about vaccines and death rate and social distancing and masks and all that stuff.
Right.
They more than ever just want to watch the game.
And have it feel like it felt a year ago.
Give us normal again. Yeah. Even, I mean, we made fake crowd noise just so it didn't sound like a golf tournament, you know, when we were on the air. So I think you put all that together that I think that also opened myself up to realize, you know what, I need to take a step closer to HUD in this here because most people, now there's some fans out there that, you know, feel like the games won't play anymore. We'll stop playing if they stop tweeting about the games, you know what I mean? But most fans go to work, come home, have dinner with their family, put their kids to bed, put on the game and watch it for a while and decide if they want to watch the end of it or not, go to bed, wake up the next day, go to work, talk about the game for about 5 minutes and go on with their lives.
Repeat the process.
Mm-hmm. So how can I accommodate those people? Because, you know, the people that are tweeting all the time, you know, they think they know more than I do anyway. So there's nothing I'm going to say that's going to interest them because the whole time, you know, they know more than I do. So hopefully I don't offend them and their fans also, but I'm appealing more to the people who don't watch every single pitch of every single game and try and bring them in to what's going on. And so that should be entertainment. And if HUD cracks a good joke and we can have some fun on the air and someone's in their couch and they're laughing and they're not thinking about the argument that they just had with their boss 3 hours ago,
right?
Maybe then we've done our job.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you've done several ball games over the years. I've watched several of them or heard several of them, and I can't pinpoint a specific game where I said, man, that is the best ball game with all of the, you know, just thoroughly communicating the analytics of the game and the stats and everything. That's the best game Ryan Lefebvre has ever broadcast. Mm-hmm. But I can remember when you talked about the moon being the planet, I can remember the time you had a conversation about Salvi potentially being a New York Yankee. Yeah. That's the raw honesty that people will remember. And I love the fact that you did kind of sway in the direction of HUD in that direction, because you're getting the best of both worlds.
So
now,
my first year with the Royals, and we've already gone over how hard that was for me. And I mean, our pregame and postgame guys were questioning whether I was any good that first year. I mean, it was really hard, but there was an extra inning game, and we alternate the extra innings on radio. So I got to call an exciting walk-off win at Kauffman Stadium. It was my first year. I knew, like, I nailed it. It was a good call. On the drive home, I'm listening to the postgame, and they played it, and I was like, that was a good call. And even the postgame guys are like, ah, that was pretty good. You know, maybe this guy's not so bad. So I go to sleep. I wake up the next day. I drive in. I'm listening to sports talk radio, and they played the call again, and the guys are like, ah, that wasn't so bad, you know, whatever. Yeah, so I get to the ballpark. I'm like, okay,
got some swag.
Sounded good. I walk into the ballpark, and there's about four or five fans, and this is like 3:30 in the afternoon for a 7 o'clock game. And here come these three or four fans, and they come right to me before I get in the stadium. And they're like, Ryan, that was a great game last night. And I was like, yeah, and like, we were listening. I was like, great. That conversation you and Denny had about his tomato plants, that was hilarious. So there you go. Right. That's what people remember.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're short on time now, and I wanted to talk about the downtown ballpark. I don't think we're going to be able to get into that, unfortunately, because we really got to use these last 10 minutes to talk about why I really wanted you here in the first place.
Or does that become part two?
That maybe. I don't know.
Because, I mean, now you're down to 9 minutes, and that's I mean, I've got two things I want to, that would take more than 9 minutes.
Okay.
I have notes, so.
I don't know.
I don't know.
I don't know. I don't know. What do I do here? What do I do? I think, what do you want to do? What do you think, Ryan? I'm the host of a show telling my guests, what do you think we should do? I tell you what, it's important to me to talk about the mental health side.
Yeah.
And that's why I wanted you here. I think there may be an opportunity, because obviously the downtown ballpark is going to be, you know, if it's going to happen, it's going to be a little bit. And so there'll be another opportunity we can have you in to talk about the intricacies of that. There's a lot of debate on social media, fans that don't want it because the parking situation and stuff. And so maybe if you can bless us sometime in the future to come back to talk about that, we would love to have you.
Sure.
I wanted to get into the mental health side of this. A very good friend of mine who is a super fan of the show. She also has connected with me in the show because of what I was able to share through the mental health side, shared with me after my very first episode when I came out about my issues, sent the YouTube link that I sent you, Jill, of you talking at Journey Church and in your story. And I was like, wow. And I had heard you talk. I listened to Nate and Steven in Saran on 810 all the time. And so I have heard them have conversation with you about your battle. But I guess I would love for you to kind of tell your story in the best way you can with the, and you're going to have to spare a couple minutes extra because we've got 7 minutes now left before you have to leave based on the timeline
you gave us.
Yeah.
You and I have got something similar with our struggle with depression and anxiety. And did you have suicidal ideation?
Yeah. So I wrote a book, and the book is mostly about 2005. That was my rock bottom year, August of 2005, where I was living in a big house on Lake Winnebago with a boat and a jet ski down at the dock and two nice cars in the garage, broadcasting Major League Baseball on radio and TV. And one night I found myself lying in the fetal position in the closet of my house all alone, crying out for the comfort of my mother. And so I knew something was terribly wrong with me. I think when I look back, I'd had some form of depression, not being depressed because my life circumstance caused me to be depressed, but to have depression, meaning that my life circumstance and my feelings did not line up. There was nothing terrible going on or happening in my life, but I was reacting as if there was. And so that's when the treatment began. I had to do a month and a half of a Major League Baseball season feeling this way. And it was a struggle every day just to go to the ballpark and going to the bathroom in between innings, just to cry for about 5 minutes, just to pull myself through it. And then I went on medication, and it was in early September. And everyone told me that, you know, it takes about a month to get into your system. And I remember it was 1 month and 1 day, and we were in Toronto. And it was a Saturday night game. We had one more game left in the season. in 2005. And by the way, it was the worst season in Royals history.
Yep.
We lost 106 games. So I always say I was depressed at home and I was depressed at the stadium. I mean, nothing was going right.
Right.
And it was 1 month and one day, and I was lying in bed in my hotel in Toronto, and I didn't feel any better. In fact, I probably felt worse. And it was the first time that I started to think about suicide. Now, I wasn't planning it out and when I was going to do it and how I was going to do it. Mm-hmm. But as I shared with my church, which you heard online, I had a high school teammate named Sean Fitzpatrick who went off to college and took his life. And he left a letter for his family. And the only thing I know about that letter was that he said he just wanted to go be with God.
Mm.
So there was a faith there, but there was a lack of hope here on earth that his life was going to get any better. So he went off to the comfort of the Father in his mind. I never forgot that. And I remember lying in bed Saturday night. Tomorrow is the last game of the season, and then I'm going to be alone because I was single. I'm going to be alone in my house for 5 months and just scared to death of what that looked like. And in a moment of prayer, I asked God if I did what Fitzy did, if this doesn't get any better and I don't want to be here anymore, would you accept me? And the answer that I got was that, yes, I would be accepted. But would I allow him to use this? Would I allow God to take what's going on with me right now and stop deadlines of 1 month of medication and this counseling session and how long is it going to take until I feel better? Will you allow me to do something with this? And I accepted that. Now, I can't tell you that I woke up the next day feeling better. I felt terrible the next day, terrible anxiety, heart racing, sweating, barely got through that last game of the season, had to fly back to Kansas City. But my mindset changed. It wasn't about me getting better because I want to be happy. I started to write a lot more. I started to journal in retrospect of some difficult days in the weeks prior to that, putting it into words. There became a purpose. And again, things didn't get better right away, but why I was going through this, at least for the short term, there was some meaning behind that. I'm doing this because God's doing something in my life. And I've shared before that my depression actually, now that it's, you know, we're talking about 17 years since I went through this, I realized that my depression was the answer to a prayer. Mm-hmm. I was a very broken young man. I lost my virginity when I was 14 years old. I started drinking heavily when I was 14 years old. I was a very destructive young man. Now, all this was going on around me in Southern California in the 1980s. That's just what knucklehead athlete guys did, and just hopefully you didn't get in trouble. But this was going on all around me. But yet, the brokenness just was exacerbated over the years. Now, great things were happening to me, but it wasn't fixing my brokenness.
Right.
And so I knew that, and I went to an event that Mike Sweeney, who had become a close friend, was speaking. And Mike Sweeney talked about in the Bible that in Psalms, I believe, and other parts where, and maybe even Proverbs as well, but the scripture talks about God refining us as a goldsmith or a silversmith refines gold and silver. And that when you read the Bible, you just kind of read that and you move on to the next verse. But he went on to say that in those days, how they would refine the precious metals was they'd get the raw material, and the silversmith or the goldsmith would light a match underneath the fine metal, and the impurities would then come to the surface. And the silversmith or the goldsmith would wipe those impurities away as they continued to come to the surface until the silversmith or goldsmith could see their own reflection in the metal, and then they would pull the flame away. Otherwise, you take the process too far and you damage the metal. But that was the process of purifying fine metals. And I remember hearing that and going to bed that night and praying for purification in my life. I knew I needed purification in my life, and thinking that I was going to wake up purified the next day, because that's what Jesus does. We admit to our sins. We confess our sins.
And if you ask, you shall receive.
We repent and everything is good. Well, I did not change my lifestyle, but I somehow decided that I had been purified because of that prayer. And so I think what I had forgotten about that prayer was the match. Mm. And if I was going to be purified, that they were going to have to be burnt to the surface. And that was the answer to my prayer, was my depression. Mm. I had to deal with those impurities, and they had to be burnt to the surface. Mm. And yet, by the grace of God, those impurities, in God's eyes, took me a while for me to accept in my own eyes, but in God's eyes, he was wiping away those impurities until he saw his reflection in me, and he pulled the flame away.
Wow.
So when I look back on this whole story now, it was an answer to a prayer. Winston Churchill once famously said, when you find yourself in hell, keep going. And what I had to do is I found myself in hell, and I had three choices. I could either stand there forever and just be a victim and carry that victim label of my depression and say, this is this curse that I have to carry. This is the cross that I have to bear in my depression. And it becomes a comfort zone or familiar zone. And I just choose to be a victim of my depression.
Right.
The other choice is to turn around and say, I'm getting the hell out of here, mm-hmm. and go back to the beginning. And I never really deal with my hell. And I just kind of stay on the outside and say, you know what? The cure is more painful than the disease for me. Mm. I'm not getting any better, but I don't want to go back in there again, right? Mm. The third choice I have is just to trust God and just keep going. And I don't know when I'm going to get better. Mm. I don't know if I'm going to get better, but I'm going to keep going. And that was really my motivation was I might end up not winning this battle with depression. But to borrow an old baseball expression, if I was going to go down, I was going to go down swinging. Mm-hmm. So I dove into my counseling. I had a life coach. I was on medication for 3.5 years. I went to seminars. I read books. I really went after it. And that's what got me through it.
Wow. What's a fascinating story. Whew. Go ahead. I know you got something. You had a couple things written down.
I know, but we're over time. I mean, I can't keep him from picking up his kids, you know, like I can't do that, but I want to talk about, I want to talk about the monastery. I want to talk about, in the interview with your pastor, one of the things you said is that God is trying to communicate with us all the time.
Constantly.
And that, like, yeah. I mean, I totally agree with that, but I'd never really thought about that in those exact words, mm-hmm. but it's so true.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Ryan, I know you got to get out of here. We got to do this again sometime if you will give us the opportunity, because I, as a sports geek, got talking baseball and you're
My first story was about 11 minutes long, so I apologize about that.
But. It's all right. But what I will say for anybody who's watching or listening to this is that I'm going to post the YouTube link to Ryan's entire story from when he spoke at his church, the Journey Church in Lee Summit. And it is really, really, really good. I think it picks up to the 24, 25 minute mark. If you want to fast forward through the worship service part of it. But it's really, really good.
I'll say this, Ronnie, sorry to cut you off. I'll say this. I get an opportunity to speak quite a bit, and I've gotten more opportunities to speak at churches on Sunday, which is an incredible honor and a miracle that God would use me in a church.
Yeah.
But on January 22nd, which will be 3 days shy of my 25 years of sobriety,
wow.
I'm going to speak at Blue Springs Assembly Church on Sunday, January 22nd.
Okay.
So that's a plug for a church other than my own, but they've trusted me to give my story. And I tell you what, I have some really amazing answered prayers stories on dates where God made it very clear that I've remembered your prayer and I've answered it on this day, just so you remember that I didn't forget about this prayer and the date. And so hopefully you and I and Jillian will have a chance to talk again before that. But
I really want to do that. I'm sorry that it went long and we didn't get to do this as much as, because I told you on the phone, this is really the purpose for having you here. But my sports fan got in the way. Real quick, plug the book.
Yeah. The name of the book is The Shame of Me, One Man's Journey to Depression and Back. Jeffrey Flanagan, a longtime writer at The Star, and MLB.com. Yeah. He was my co-author, and it's available on Amazon. And the title of the book comes from a chapter, and I named the chapter The Shame of Man, and how men struggle getting through depression because it just feels so shameful to be depressed, you know, especially if you're like me and everything is going great and all these other men are living vicariously through me, but it wasn't the life that I was called to have. So I called the chapter The Shame of Man, and Flanny loved the name of that chapter. So he came up with the idea, The Shame of Me. And so it's my journey in and out of depression and dealing with my shame.
And then last thing, if somebody is listening to this who is struggling, it's the holidays right now. And sometimes it's supposed to be the most joyful, happiest time of the year, but it can also be the most depressing and most painful and stressful for some. If somebody's listening to this right now and they're contemplating suicide, or they know they're dealing with an emotion that they can't control, in your best way, in a quick summary, what is your best advice for them to do?
Have you thanked God for what you're going through right now?
Wow.
That's the best I can give
That's
you.
That's the best answer and a short answer.
Start there.
Okay.
Have you thanked God for what you're going through and he's allowing you to go through with him? Have you thanked God?
Okay. You've been listening to the Whoops, I didn't mean to do that. Hang on, let's do this. All right. This is supposed to be the bumper bed where we end the episode. Sorry, I hit the wrong button. We're going to wrap this up. Thank you so much, Ryan.
Yeah.
I really want to do this again as we wrap this up. I want to make sure to remind you, you can catch this podcast on any of your favorite podcast platforms. A video version is available on Spotify and YouTube. Thank you, Jillian, for being here. I'm glad you're feeling better. And thank you for our guest, Ryan Lefebvre. That's episode 26 of the Papa Ron Podcast.
You've been listening to the Papa Ron Podcast. MHD. If you enjoyed the show, hit subscribe now and tell your friends on Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, TikTok, and other social platforms. To participate on the show, leave a message with your comments or questions by calling or texting 816-558-6389. That's 816-558-6389. Until next time, thanks for listening to the Papa Ron Podcast. Papa Ron Podcast.